Good morning. This is really exciting, as you all heard. How many of you truly believe that in 5 years' time, machine learning and artificial intelligence will be the key factor determining the competitiveness of your organization? No one. Really? What have you been doing all morning? Sleeping? Let me ask again. How many of you really believe that in 5 years' time, AI will be a key factor, not necessarily the, but a key factor in the competitiveness of your organization? Okay, this is more like it. How many of you really understand how machine learning works? Hands up. Okay. You are self-confident. That's good. This early in the morning. Typically, when one talks with the CEO, chairman-type audience, people feel confident that this is big stuff. This is really, really important. But they have absolutely no idea what the technology does. And I'm a bit shocked by that. So where are we going when our leaders are sure that this technology will define them, will define their business, but they are not making a move to understand how the technology works? And I can say this because I'm one of them. I have been given presentations like yours with one difference to you. You understand what you're talking about. You understand the background. I didn't. I really didn't. And I was giving all these grand presentations, making people excited, and I sounded good, or at least pretty good. I was convincing. But I didn't know why these things would happen. So when you just heard that these systems can predict your age within months, is that true? Do you believe it? It's not true. Not true. There's a probability distribution within which the system can predict your age if you are one of the types of people for whom they have statistical information that they have used to train the system. If you belong to that group, then there's a probability that they can predict your age. If you are somebody else that for some reason they have ignored, they haven't figured out that sort of people like you exist, they don't have data on you, then all bets are off. They have no idea how old you are. There are many reasons why you need to understand how machine learning works, and you need to make sure that your CEO understands, and even your chairman probably should understand a little bit of it. Would you take a chairman who doesn't read? Would you? Maybe you have. I don't know. I don't know. But you shouldn't. You should teach the guy to read. If it were a she would know how to read, but if it's a guy, it's possible that he doesn't know how to read. Okay. So I'll talk a little bit about how machine learning works. And maybe this is boring to some of you because you know all this stuff already, but there were a few hands that were not raised. And maybe some of the ways I'm explaining this might be useful for you as you now will go to the boardroom to teach your chairman about machine learning. So I'll talk a little bit about why it's so topical right now, very quickly, you know all about that, what machine learning truly means, why it is important for you, and how your organization can be better prepared. I'll not talk about AI. As you know, machine learning is one of the subcategories of AI, but it is by far the most impactful one. When you read from the news about anything that AI has done, it's like 99% sure that it's about machine learning. But there's lots of stuff underneath machine learning as well. And I'll only scratch the surface a little bit. We already heard which jobs AI will replace. I'll not tell you exactly what to do. You had some ideas from Malcolm's presentation. But I'll tell you that this is important. It's important to learn. If you don't learn, you will not be able to ask the right questions. You will not be able to have the right doubts in your minds when somebody comes to you with a big claim on what AI will mean to you. And you'll have no clue whether you should be doubtful or not, and what questions you should be asking. So all of us know about traditional programming, where we have some data, we have a program, we run the program using the data as input, and we get some output. That's how programs work. In machine learning, we have data, we have the output, and with the help of that data and the answers, we'll actually create a program. The system will create the program for us. And this is machine learning. This is the essence of machine learning. So what does it mean in practice? I have a bit of a naive example here. So we have dots. This dot means that there is an apartment of roughly 200 square meters. The cost was 2,500 euros per square meter. That's the data. Each of the dots gives you two data points about an apartment in downtown Helsinki. So that's the first circle, data. The second circle was the output, or the answers. And here's the output, or the answers. The red dots signify an apartment that was sold in less than a month. The blue dots signify an apartment that it took longer than 1 month to sell. So now the question based on this data is, what is the program that can give you an answer for whether a new apartment that comes to the market can be sold in less than a month or not? So what is the answer? What is the program? All of you can create that program in a second, because you visually see the answer. This is the program. You can all do that. But of course, this is completely silly, because you cannot predict how quickly an apartment can be sold just using the size and the price per square meter as input. You can't. You need to know the address. You need to know whether it's an apartment block or a private house, which floor, how old, when was it renovated last, and so forth and so forth. Maybe the color of the kitchen walls will have an impact. You just don't know. So if we would add all those parameters here as well, you would maybe have, let's say, 25 parameters. So try visualizing that 25-dimensional space. This is two dimensions. That's easy. You can immediately visualize the line that delimits the right area. In 25-dimensional space, can you imagine the surface that would encompass all the red dots? You can't. For a machine, it really doesn't matter how many dimensions there are. It doesn't even understand what a dimension is. It's just doing math. And when you do math, it's just a bit more calculations where there are more parameters. That's it. So the machine can draw that line or create the surface in a 25-dimensional space like this. You could never do that. Just too much data, too many dimensions. And that's really the difference between us and the machines. And this is why machine learning can do things that we can't. Because it doesn't care. It doesn't even understand about the dimensions. So what is that? Anybody can make a guess. It's skin cancer. So what is that? It's a bitmap. Every single pixel, in this case, has three numeric values, all between 0 and 255. It's just numbers. Just like this was just numbers, a bunch of numbers. This is the data, a big bunch of numbers. And then we have the output, which in this case is, yes, this is skin cancer. If you have enough pictures of skin cancer, enough pictures of other types of skin ailments, all just bunch of numbers, and you know which one is skin cancer and which one is not, you can ask a machine learning system to create a model that fits that data. And this is all that this example did. It created a model that fits the data that is here. This line is a model that fits this data, as you can all visually see. It's a little bit more challenging for us humans to understand how the system creates a model that fits this data. But mathematically, it's the same thing. There's no difference. Just like this bitmap, categorizing objects. If we just have enough images, which is the data, and then we have the answers, this is a cat, that's the answer. And then we have fire trucks and ladders and buckets and cups and what have you. It's just data. Just feed it to the system. If you have enough data, it's high enough quality, it will learn. And it will create a model that fits that data. And then when you feed a new picture to it, it will give you a probabilistic answer as to what is in that picture. When the forward-looking camera in a self-driving car, she sees this type of an object, it needs to know whether to brake or whether to drive through. But you can teach that just the same way as we can teach about skin cancer. Sometimes when the wind blows some dry leaves over the road, it may visually look a little bit like this. For the self-driving car, it needs to be able to make that difference in a very reliable fashion. And you can teach that. Audio waves, just numbers. That's the data. The output could be that we will write down the words that are spoken. And we'll define which part of the audio wave fits or matches which word. And we can teach a system that understands and can convert audio to text. And then we can train another system that translates those words to another language. And a third system that converts in that other language those words to spoken words. Maybe a little bit more complicated than that, but theoretically, that's all you need to do. So let's take this previous example. We had the two inputs, square meters and price per square meter, and then we added the other parameters that we have data for. And we'll do a logistic regression, which is the simplest machine learning algorithm. It's really, really simple. So we'll just give each input parameter a weight. And you can, it's intuitively it makes sense, because not all those parameters are equally important. Some of them have much more meaning to how quickly can we sell the apartment. For example, if the price is rock bottom, obviously you can sell it very quickly. And then pretty much the other parameters don't perhaps even matter that much. So that input would have a high weight. And then the only thing we do is we multiply each input with its own weight and we sum them all up. So it's just multiplication and addition. And we get a number. It can be a really low number on the negative side or a really high number on the positive side. And then we need to convert it into a probability. So we use a nonlinear function. There are many that are used in machine learning. Sigmoid is a typical one. TanH is another one. ReLU is a third one. It doesn't matter how they work, and they're actually very simple. They can work like this. So a very low negative number would equal to minus one. Very high positive number would equal to plus one. And then in between, let's say 0.5 would actually result in, or minus 0.5 would result in minus 0.5, roughly. It's a nonlinear function that compresses all numbers to a given range. And we can say that minus 1 would be 0 probability and plus 1 would be 100% probability. and that's it. So with those multiplications and additions, and then the nonlinear function, a probability comes out. So the trick is to find the right weights. Everything else is given here. The only thing we don't know are the weights. And machine learning is about automatically finding those weights or training those weights based on the data that we have for teaching. This is a bit more complicated example. So humans write numbers in various ways, and especially doctors are trained to write them in very, very strange ways. So there are some doctors in this sample as well. So we have about 5,000 samples, so 500 for each digit, 500 zeros and 500 ones and so forth. And we'll show one of them here. So that's clearly an 8. It's a 20-20 matrix. So we have 400 numbers. This is grayscale, so there's only one number per pixel. If it were color, there would be three numbers per pixel. And there you see the numbers. They are still arranged in this rectangular matrix. So you can actually still see the 8 visually. But if we sort them on top of each other, you can't see the 8 anymore. But the machine cannot see the 8 here either. It really doesn't know what an 8 is. So it's all the same for the machine, whether we put them next to each other or on top of each other. But anyway, visually, here we have 400 numbers. And then we give each one of a weight. And then we multiply them together and we sum them up. And then we apply the nonlinear function. And we do 10 of these. We train one system to recognize the zeros, one system to recognize the ones, and so forth. And if we train them well with good data, then for each image of a number, one of the 10 would give a high probability and 9 of the 10 would give a low probability. And if that's the outcome, then with high reliability, the system has recognized the number correctly. With this algorithm, we get to 75% accuracy with these 5,000 samples. So not nearly good enough. But for such a simple algorithm, it's kind of amazing that it can do that. You all have heard about neural networks and deep learning. So I'll show you how you would use a simple neural network for this same purpose. So we start with the same. We have the 400 pixels. We have 10 output categories. We need to define whether the image is one of those 10 categories. And then, as different from the previous example, we'll add a new layer into the image, which is a hidden layer. And when we talk about deep learning, we just have multiple hidden layers. It becomes deeper, a stack. And that's all deep learning is. Instead of a single hidden layer, you have 5 or 10 hidden layers, and it's already deep learning. You can have 100 hidden layers in really complicated neural networks. And it would be really, really deep learning in that case. And then each line here shows you one multiplication. So each one of the input pixels, like this one, which is that pixel there, or the value of that pixel in the top left-hand corner, it has a multiplier connected to each one of these 25 hidden layers. So there are 25 separate weights for that first pixel. And what we do is we multiply the pixel value with its weight and put the result into each one of these cells. But each one of these cells will get 399 other values into it from each one of the 399 other input pixel values. So there will be 400 values to add up here. And then we'll apply the nonlinear algorithm, and we'll get a value which typically would be between 0 and 1 or minus 1 and 1 here. And then we'll do the same again. So you see a link from this pixel, this cell, to each one of the 10 output categories, and the same for each one of these 25 hidden cells. So there's a set of additional multiplications. And each one of the output categories will get 25 numbers to add up. And then applying the nonlinear algorithm, we get a probability. And that's how it works. Again, the only trick is finding the right weights. So how does that work? We start with random weights, and we calculate what would be the outcome. And we get completely random probabilities here. So for example, for this 8, we might get a 95% probability that it's a 3, and we would get a 17% probability that it's an 8. But we know the answer. We know that it should be an 8. So if the 3 was 95%, there's a 95 percentage point error here. We know that it's wrong. We know how much it is wrong. And if this was 17, we know that there's an 83 percentage point error because it should be 100. So then we can calculate what the mistake was, and using what is called backpropagation, basically partial derivatives, simple high school math basically, we can deduce which direction to change each of the weights so that the error becomes smaller. And it doesn't matter how the math works. It's actually not that complicated. The only thing that is really complicated about these models is that there's so many numbers. It gets hard to understand for a human being because of the amount of the multiplications and additions. And this is a tiny neural network, tiny, tiny neural network. And it's still difficult to comprehend how this all fits together. So we know how to change the weights and in which direction, and we nudge them just a little bit. Not sort of trying to get to the right answer immediately, we just nudge them a little bit. And then we take other samples, do the same thing, and again nudge the weights a little bit. And that's how we get to the optimal weights. Just going around in this circle until we are done. So that's neural networks for you. There's much more interesting and much more interesting stuff around that. I actually created an hour and 15 minute long training presentation around this stuff, which is online. You can see it on YouTube. Starts with the same stuff, but goes a little bit deeper into how the machine learning algorithms work. But now we don't have time to do that. So I'll just show a couple images, because we can go to a neural network, a convolutional neural network that identifies objects in images. And we can take a particular output cell, for example, a cell that identifies human beings, and we can calculate backwards, asking what kind of an image would fully satisfy the requirements of this category. So instead of using the system the normal way where we give it an image and ask what is in this image, and then it gives us the output categories and the probabilities, we do it the other way around. We say that we want to get the image that is more human or most human in your opinion, and we calculate in the other direction. And these are images that have been created in that way. So this is the way a particular neural network thinks about human beings. These are electronics. This is architecture and nature. So no human being visualizes these objects in this way. This is alien, and that's part of the fascination of machine learning. It is an alien way to come to conclusions from the point of view of humans. That's its strength, and that's the weakness. The strength in the sense that it can conclude things very, very differently from the way we humans think. And that's Lee Sedol's game 2, move 37. You didn't mention that, did you? So AlphaGo played that move 37. Lee Sedol looked at the board, stood up, walked into the toilet, and flushed his head with cold water because he was so shocked. And the whole world of Go players was shocked. They say that no human being has ever played that type of a move. And it was a brilliant move. And Lee Sedol lost that game. And the point is that just by this math, these multiplications and additions, training the weights, a neural network can come up with answers that no human being has ever thought about. We can potentially solve questions that we have, as humankind, we have been thinking about for centuries or millennia. The weakness of it is also that this is alien. Sometimes that answer may be completely wrong for various reasons, and we'll discuss those in a moment. So, in this very small neural network, we had 10,250 weights. And when we trained it, we did about 205 trillion calculations. That may sound like a lot. It would be a lot if we would have to do them using a handheld calculator. It would take us a long time. For a computer, nowadays, it's meaningless. It's not that much. So I had these 10,250 connections. There's a mistake there. So very, very small network. A really large neural network might have 160 billion connections. So think about it. If 10,250 connections resulted in 205 trillion calculations during the training phase, how many calculations would a 160 billion connection network require when training? The number of calculations is enormous. And of course, now we have more computing capacity than we have ever had before. We're getting more every day. So we can do these huge networks. Anybody guess how many connections there are in the human brain? There are about 150 trillion connections in the human brain. Plus, we have algorithms that are much more sophisticated than the backprop algorithm we use to train neural networks. We don't know how the algorithms in our head work. It's unknown. But we know that when a young child puts his or her hand on a hot stove, they don't have to repeat that 10,000 times to learn not to do it. So we have more sophisticated algorithms in our heads than what we use to train neural networks. And one day we will find out how those algorithms work. And after that one day, we will be applying them for machine learning as well. And that may be the sort of non-linearity that can lead to the intelligence explosion. Nowadays, we have no line of sight to that intelligence explosion. Something dramatic has to happen for it to become possible. And we have no way of predicting when and how something like that could happen. But being able to copy the algorithms from our heads might be that change. So, just summarizing, you build a machine learning system, you collect high-quality annotated data, you choose the right type of approach, you initialize your parameters, you calculate the outcome with the random values, you measure the error, you nudge all parameters in all layers towards the minimum of the cost function. That's a complicated way of saying that we just move towards a little bit smaller error in the system. Then we calculate the outcome again using the nudged weights, and we determine whether we still need to continue training or whether we are happy. And then we just circle in that loop as long as it takes. If the system stops learning, then we should stop teaching. There's no use anymore. Or if we have achieved previously set targets for accuracy, then we might stop as well. And this is what we get. This was the best outcome with these overall parameters. And then we need to test it. We need to test the system with data that was not used to train it. It's just like our kids. If they have a test at school and all the questions are exactly identical to what they have studied in class, they will answer better. But if you ask, let's say in a math test, very different questions, but about the same topic, they will not answer as well. And the same applies here. We need to test it with data it has never seen before. And then we get a measure of how well it works in real life. And if this was not acceptable as an outcome, we may go back to getting better data. We may change the size of the neural network, adding more hidden layers and what have you. Or we may change the algorithms. Instead of using just the neural network, we may try some other models. If we were happy, we have a production system. And running that production system is much, much faster than training it. So whereas we might need to do training for complicated systems in the cloud, we may still be able to run them in a video camera attached to the wall. Because running them is always less computing intensive than training them. But with the advent in computing capacity, we may end up with systems that can be trained at the edge of the network as well. And that's, of course, a big thing for telcos and for companies such as Nokia, because we want to put computing capacity at the edge of the network so that we can adapt to local requirements, to local conditions. We can train systems at the local level. That's important, let's say, for massive MIMO. So that if there's a train track going across the area that the massive MIMO antenna covers, the system learns to adapt to the fact that some users travel at 400 kilometers per hour, whereas downtown in an area where people only walk, the conditions are very, very different. And the system will automatically learn and adapt. But then we can also build consumer-oriented systems or enterprise systems where the learning happens at the local level. You sell a network access to an enterprise for an industrial site, but you also sell them the ability to build machine learning systems using your edge cloud computing capacity. Because there's unused capacity at the base station. And you could sell that. A lot of opportunities for value creation. So what I showed you were very simple architectures. There's a convolutional neural network where the fully connected neural network is only at this side of the overall architecture. There's some other stuff that happens at this front end. And there's a long short-term network where we actually have four neural networks, these four. And this is a system that has a memory. So if, for example, if you want to build the automatic journalist, it really has to remember what the previous word was that it put into the sentence. If you think about the neural network that I showed, it has no idea. You just feed it something and then it comes with an outcome. You could feed the previous word to it, but it wouldn't remember the word before that. But this one has a memory. And I find it fascinating that it has been found out that this system works better when there's a neural network here that is trained to forget. Just like we human beings, you know, time heals all wounds, we forget. And it's part of the reason why humans are so good. we forget bad stuff, and then we go forward. And funnily enough, this system works better when it can forget as well. And there's a separate neural network that just studies what it should learn, what it should forget. And there's a probably the most recent breakthrough in machine learning, and this is several years old, a generative adversarial network that generates its own training data in an interesting way. And then, of course, we use all these architectures, we combine them with traditional programming, and we build systems of systems. So it gets a bit more complicated than what I just showed you, and there's many ways you can adjust the basic models. But you also need to understand what doesn't work. Here we can see an Abrams battle tank. Anybody recognize what this is? T-72, who said that? Wow, well done. Well done, you're an anti-tank officer. Yeah, well, I'm from Finland, so a Soviet tank was a logical guess. So the US military trained a machine learning system to be used at the battlefield that would identify and recognize enemy tanks as opposed to friendly tanks. And as training material, they used photos such as these. And what did the system learn? It learned to recognize high-quality photographs from low-quality photographs. So think about when they first try this out and it's a foggy morning. They will first blow up all their own tanks. And sometimes these happen accidentally. The developers really didn't sort of figure out that, hey, all our photos of Soviet tanks are taken from an exercise with a long telephoto lens from far away. And maybe the system is actually learning to recognize the quality of the photograph and not the content of the photograph. Sometimes the people coding the system or training the system have a personal bias, something they just believe in, which is not true. But they pick the training data in such a way that it corresponds to what they believe in, and they are training their own bias to the system without even understanding that they have a bias. If you would ask them, they would say that, no, I don't have any bias against people of other races or against people of other genders, or I have no bias. But yet they transfer their own bias to the system. And we need to understand that that risk exists so that we can also verify that a system that has our corporate brand on it and our customers are using doesn't contain a bias that would go against our values or would be otherwise destructive to our business. In China, they tried a system where they used photographs from the penal system, so people who are in prison, and then a bunch of photographs of people who have not been to prison. And they wanted to see whether they can identify who's in prison and who is not. And they tried to remove all the effects of the, sort of the backgrounds of the photos and the lighting and other stuff. And 85% accuracy, you could detect who is in prison. And that's wonderful. Think about it. When you get your driver's license and you go and pick it up, just form two lines. One goes to prison and the other one goes out to the street. What a saving. Preemptive, predictive imprisonment. A wonderful system. Well, this research was buried, luckily. You know, here's again a picture of cat. And of course, the human race is fully focused on generating as many pictures of cats online as possible. So there's lots and lots of pictures of cats. And each one gets a probability that it's a cat. So think about which picture has the highest probability of all the billions of pictures of cats. What would that picture be like? Because there is one photo out there that has a higher possibility than all the other photos. Yeah, yeah. You all have your own ideas. The I don't know what it's at the moment for Google, let's say, but it used to be a bunch of cats, a herd of cats, because obviously a group of cats have more cat-like components than any single cat. Did anyone here think about a group of cats? And this is the alien thing. We don't think the way these systems think. And this is a trivial example. But think about when you train a system to do nuclear safety, and you assume that it's thinking about a single cat. But actually, it's not, because it doesn't think the way we think. Here's a picture of a panda. And this particular system recognized it as a panda with a 57% confidence. And then we changed that bitmap just a little bit. You see the changed bitmap here. There's no visual difference. We can't see any difference between those two. But what we do is we add a carefully pre-calculated bunch of numbers which visualized in a bitmap looks like this. But we divide it by 0.007 or multiply it with that number. So it becomes so faint that if I would show this picture after this multiplication, it would just be a white rectangle. You wouldn't see anything. So we make tiny, tiny, tiny changes to it. And guess what? This outcome is not a panda anymore. It's a gibbon. Clearly it's a gibbon. Can't you see that? With a 99.3% confidence. So it's almost absolutely certain that this is a gibbon, where it was not nearly as sure that this is a panda. I could make the system believe that this is a fire truck, probably adding three red dots on the photo in carefully calculated locations. And any human being would see that, hey, it's a picture of a panda with a couple red dots on it. The machine learning system would say that 99% sure it's a fire truck. And think about it, this as a giant game of these small metal balls that you start rolling, and they roll, there are forks in the paths, and they go all around, and there's thousands and thousands of them. And the idea is that the balls would end up in buckets at the end of it, and there are 10,000 categories at the end. And you start these tens of thousands of balls rolling, and they, depending on how big the balls are, how heavy they are, they will take certain paths, and they will all end up in the panda box. But as I know how this roller coaster thing works, I'll just make tiny tweaks to the balls. And I can make them take slightly different turns along the way. And they will all end up in the fire truck box. When I know how this sort of roller coaster in between works. But how do we prevent this? Any ideas? Let's say this is for recognizing notes, i.e. money. And somebody can use just white paper with four green dots, and the system is 100% sure that they are $100 bills with copy paper. How do we prevent that? We harden the system by training it with pictures of pandas with red dots and green dots and blue dots and circles and lines and scratches, and we just need to train it in a way that it learns to make the right identification despite the noise that might be there. We don't do this if we don't realize that it's necessary. So my point is that you have to understand a little bit of how machine learning works in order to figure out that, hey, you team leader who's presenting this wonderful machine learning system to us, what have you done to make sure that this can't be fooled? You have to know to ask that question. You may not necessarily understand the answer, but at least if there is an answer, it's a positive thing. Unless the answer is that, what do you mean? You remember Tay, the Microsoft bot that tweets. It was a reinforcement learning based system, so it learned from every tweet it received. And it became a pretty nasty bot very, very quickly. The final thing was that it became a Nazi and started claiming that Hitler actually did nothing wrong, and then Microsoft took it offline. So again, if people teach it with certain data, it will learn and it will become like the teachers. I believe there's six things that any company should do and could do for machine learning to get on the way. The first one is spread understanding of what is machine learning. So for example, in Nokia, our plan is that all our 100,000 employees will have gone through a basic course by the end of this year. Every single one. It's like code of conduct training. Everybody has to do it. It's not very sophisticated, but they get sort of this idea that we are talking about here. And our people appreciate that a lot. They appreciate that we want them to learn. And we want to invest in training them in some sophisticated stuff that they might have thought that they cannot learn in advance. But then they found out that, hey, this is not that complicated after all. And they feel good about themselves and they feel good about the company. Then we need to have a resource that has top expertise, because when these 100,000 people will start bumping into business problems that they think could be solved using machine learning, and then they will start proposing projects, we need people who can help them figure out what should be done and what shouldn't be done, what's possible, what's not possible. How do we prioritize those projects? We are running hundreds of machine learning projects at the moment, internal projects and external projects. So we have Bell Labs, which is the top research facility. We have 1,000 PhDs working in Bell Labs, and a fairly significant part of them are working on machine learning. Who knows convolutional neural networks? That's a Bell Labs invention. Did you know that? You did? Oh, wonderful. Smart guy. So Jan LeCun was working for Bell Labs when he came up with the concept of convolutional neural networks. The third one, creating a data strategy, sort of two halves. You need to have the IT infrastructure in place so that you can take any two subsets of data that your company has access to, combine those two or three or four subsets to create a training set. And you need to be able to do GDPR and all national regulation enforcement and so forth at the same time. So it's a fairly complicated task, but you need to build that kind of an infrastructure. Basically a sophisticated data lake. And then you need to have a data strategy. You need to figure out what kind of data do I need access to in 3 years' time or 5 years' time to train the machine learning systems that will define my competitiveness at that time, in 3 years or 5 years' time. Because it may be that you need to do something today to have that access in 3 years. You may need to buy your company, you may need to partner, you may need to build an app, a free app that exists only to gather that data, and it needs to be attractive to consumers or companies. You may need to take some action right now in order to guarantee your competitiveness down the road. And then you just apply it. For internally, for increased efficiency, productivity, you augment your own people, you make them better people, better experts. And then for external purposes, for your products and services, for better competitiveness for your customers. And you do all these six at the same time. You can have six people in charge of each of these parts, with budgets, with goals, with KPIs, with reporting milestones, and you just get the train moving. You don't need to know exactly what should happen. Just need to get your people on the way. so that the company starts learning. And you can figure out the rest on the way. You don't need to have a full 5-year plan like Soviet Union, which determines exactly what will happen at which stage by whom. Just get the train out of the station. And I'll finish with one thought that you should think about. You all know how internet companies work. So for example, a company like Amazon, they do a huge number of A/B tests every day. Some people claim that no two people see the same website. So there's always some tweak that they are testing you on every time you go on Amazon or Facebook or one of these services. It's a second nature to them to A/B test. You are the data source for their development, and they are using you to the fullest. And they are organized in such a way that the people who actually create the content or manage the content, they do these A/B tests. Mark Zuckerberg doesn't need to decide which A/B tests they run. In a traditional organization, like a department store, the shop clerks don't have the authority to go and make big changes in how the department store is organized. They need supervisors' permission. So they need to reorganize, they need to rethink the way they work. And my point here is that if you take a shopping mall and they create a website, they won't become an internet company. They're still a shopping mall with a website. They don't reorganize, they don't build the processes and the attitudes and instincts that an internet company has. A/B testing, short cycles, you do this at a really rapid pace. Empowerment to product managers who can test whatever they want, and they're free to go. And the same applies to AI companies. A company like Nokia starting to use neural networks doesn't make us into an AI company. We are still a tech company that just uses neural networks. Because an AI company is something different. For an AI company, the hammer and nails thing, when you have a hammer in your hand, everything looks like a nail. For an AI company, everything looks like a problem that will be solved by getting the right data. And the instinct is, where do I get the data? I have a problem, what data do I need? Who do I buy? What kind of an app do I create to get that data? That's one of the instincts. And they organize accordingly. So an AI company is not organized the way an internet company is organized. And there are a number of things that you need to think differently. An AI company attempts to automate everything. That's second nature to AI companies. And there's always new job descriptions. So I'll finish here. What I wanted to cover very briefly is intuition, why now? More capacity for computing and more data than ever before. Significant business results for certain businesses, mostly consumer-oriented internet businesses. And huge investments into machine learning and more to come. So what is machine learning? Just learning a model that fits the data to reliably predict the right outcome. Slow when you train it. Very quick when you run it. Thinks only in one direction. What do I mean with that? If I feed the system a picture of a cat, it can tell me that 99% sure this is a cat. But can you ask that system, what does a cat look like? Can it explain to you what a cat looks like? Think about it, it's just these multiplications and sums, left to right. If you start going right to left, just have a bunch of numbers. How can that explain to you what a cat looks like? But it's not completely true anymore. There's a huge investment currently underway for systems that can explain how they came up with the conclusions they came up with. We can't accept AI systems to run weapons systems or nuclear power plants or healthcare if they can't explain based on what data and what research they concluded that we should do A or B or C. And there are ways to actually figure out what does a cat look like from a system like these. It used to be more true than it's today. And remember that garbage in, garbage out. Why is this important to understand? There will just be more of everything. And there will be better algorithms. So you get more out of this more of everything. And immense value will be created. But to whom? What should be done? Spread understanding, create a data strategy, have a competence center, use for internal efficiency and quality, and use for your customers' benefit. And you can start doing all those at the same time and learn on the way. Thank you very much.